next on Unsolved Mysteries.
Put your hands above your head.
He's a convicted bank robber who says his name is Jose Antonio Gonzalez, but he's lying, and no one knows his true identity. Richard Mins was a flashy millionaire. Barbara Petrosky, a former beauty queen. It seemed like a perfect match, but it would end like this. In a frightening arson case, a house fire takes the life of a 79-year-old woman. A young man confesses, but then says his confession was coerced. The house of the infamous Lizzie Borden, the scene of a brutal double murder.
Lizzie Borden took an axe and gave her mother 40 rocks.
Some say it's haunted by the victims.
Five cases with strange clues, bizarre twists, and with secrets you would never expect. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries.
Anchorage, Alaska. Two bank employees arrive at a local mall to restock the automated teller machine. The security guard takes the cash into a small, secluded room behind the machine.
See you in a few minutes.
The teller goes outside to reprogram the ATM.
Don't turn around. Do exactly what I say, and you won't be hurt. Open the door. Put your hands above your head. You, over here. You, open the vault. Turn around.
There was nothing about this robbery that this individual wasn't prepared to handle.
On your face.
He knew the entrance into this back room, back hallway, in order to get into the teller machine. He knew that no one could see him from there.
Put the money in the bag. Put your hands behind your back.
And he knew exactly what it took in order to open up the machine, where the money was stored inside a machine, and also instructed the teller to take a videotape out of the video machine so as not to be caught on film.
Get the surveillance tape now. I know what your name is. I know where you live. Do you understand?
Yes.
Both of you, silent for 5 minutes.
The guard believed that this robber was very relaxed.
The FBI believed the robbery was an inside job. They suspected a former security guard named Jose Antonio Gonzalez. Gonzalez was already being investigated in connection with a similar robbery, but Gonzalez had conveniently disappeared. 2 days later, and 1,500 miles away, a postal worker noticed a partially opened package.
Oh, wait a minute, this one's torn. Wait a minute, looks like a gun in there.
The address that was on top of the box was an address to a gentleman named Jose Antonio Gonzalez in Redmond, Washington. The return address was Anchorage, Alaska.
Hey, Jim?
A second box was found in the same shipment, also addressed to Jose Antonio Gonzalez. Postal inspectors obtained a warrant to search both boxes and discovered a small arsenal.
Look at this. Glock. Loaded as well.
Beretta, loaded.
They also found cash, $65,540, the exact amount taken in the Anchorage ATM heist.
Make sure he gets an 1849, and we'll just wait for him.
Postal inspectors set up what they call a controlled delivery. Basically, it was a sting operation.
Sure. May I see some ID, please?
Sure.
There you go.
Just 3 days later, Jose Gonzalez stepped right into their trap.
away from the car.
What's going on?
Back away from the car. Get down on your knees.
Gonzalez was charged with armed bank robbery and four counts of illegal transportation of firearms using the U.S. mail. Once in custody, Gonzalez seemed cooperative. He told authorities his life story. Born in Puerto Rico, graduated from Knickerbocker High School in New York City, attended college at West Virginia University. Gonzalez then rattled off his Social Security number, his date of birth, and other vital statistics.
This man was almost too good with his background. Everything was right there on the tip of his tongue, from where he went to high school to where he was brought up.
But nothing Gonzalez said was true. There was no Knickerbocker High School in New York City, and no one named Jose Antonio Gonzalez had ever attended West Virginia University.
You ever been in the service?
Yes, I have. French Foreign Legion.
French Foreign Legion?
Yes.
Mr. Gonzalez indicated that he was a former French Foreign Legionnaire, that he'd seen action in Chad and Beirut. He claimed to be a martial arts expert and an expert with various types of weapons.
Where were you born?
Puerto Rico.
What city?
The FBI also discovered he had two Social Security numbers. One belonged to an 11-year-old boy, obviously a fake. But the other seemed real. It had been issued to a Jose Antonio Gonzalez.
We located a birth certificate in Puerto Rico under the name Jose Antonio Gonzalez. But then that child died of tetanus, and we have the death certificate. So we know who he is not. We don't know who he is.
The man calling himself Gonzalez was convicted of armed bank robbery and sent to prison. But his true identity remained a mystery. Investigators believe that two mysterious women might hold the key.
Hi, can I help you?
Yes, I'm here to pick up a car for Jose Gonzalez.
After the bank robber was arrested, his car was impounded by the Redmond police. The next day, a woman showed up to claim it.
Yes, I don't understand. He asked me to come and pick up his car. Is there a problem?
According to police, the woman was a possible accomplice of the mysterious robber. She went by the name Nadine Castell.
Nadine appears to be the person who acquires identification for Mr. Gonzalez. Almost like somebody that looks over him and has the documentation that he would need. She has disappeared. Absolutely disappeared, as far as we know, in the United States.
Another woman, Brenda Penninger, was Gonzalez's girlfriend at the time of the robbery. A few days after Castell was unable to get Gonzalez's car, Penninger showed up at the impound lot with all the right papers.
Penninger.
The FBI expected her arrival and asked the attendant to serve her with a subpoena.
I've been asked to give this piece.
What is it?
That's a subpoena, so you'll come before the grand jury.
A few days later, the car was found abandoned in the parking lot at the Newark, New Jersey airport.
We have to this day never located Miss Penninger. We've talked to her mother. We've talked to everyone that we knew that had contact with her. And there has been no contact that we can verify since 3 days after she picked up the car.
Update. An alert viewer called to identify the mystery robber as Milorad Zikovic, a French national. Authorities also located and questioned his two female friends. Neither has been charged with any wrongdoing in this case. Zikovic was released from prison after serving 8 years and deported to France. Next, a fairy tale romance turns into a living nightmare when a man targets his girlfriend for murder. Janie Smith of Irvine, California, is a registered nurse and a marathon racer. She is also paralyzed from the chest down as the result of a brutal attack. Janny used to have another name, Barbara Petrovsky, and another life. She was a beauty queen and a straight-A pre-med student. But that was all before she became involved in a passionate love affair. His name was Richard Mins. Richard was the one man that Barbara ever really loved. The one man whose child she carried. The one man who had promised her a bright future. And now she knows him as the one man who tried to have her killed. They met in Aspen, Colorado on the ski slopes. Barbara was just 23. Richard was a 47-year-old, sophisticated, smooth-talking millionaire.
When he first approached me, was bragging about what a great guy he was. And when he saw how that affected me, he just very, very quickly changed his persona and was very quiet, charming. And eventually, I fell head over heels in love with him.
Richard was a bodybuilder who had made his money from a chain of health spas based in Texas. He was a man who always got what he wanted, and he wanted Barbara. Barbara moved from Los Angeles to Houston
in March
to live with Richard.
And
he hired her as a model for his health spas and made her the center of his life.
Happy anniversary.
It was incredibly romantic, and it was too good to be true. I mean, we seemed to have a very good relationship. Certainly, it was magical. So there was no indication whatsoever in the beginning that there was anything that was really amiss.
My husband is in your house, and I want to see him right now.
Richard Mins had forgotten to tell Barbara one small detail.
Dick!
He was married.
You better get out of here right now!
At that point, he explained to me that he had loved me so much that he knew if he had admitted that he was not divorced, that I never would have consented to come to Houston. He explained that he was legally separated, but not divorced.
Barbara bought Min's story and accepted a peace offering, a townhouse for the two of them to share.
It's beautiful.
Barbara says that he offered to give her papers stating that the townhouse and its contents belonged to her.
When Dick was going through his divorce, he just became a completely different person, and it was something that really shocked me.
Barbara, will you stop it?
Suddenly, I saw a very paranoid, violent side of his personality.
Don't worry about it.
Min's temper became worse after the divorce settlement was finalized. His wife, who had built the health spa business with him, was awarded nearly $6 million.
Barbara, I don't want to talk.
At about that same time, Barbara discovered she was pregnant. Min suddenly put his plans to marry her on hold.
Barbara, did I pick you here? Man.
Yes! Dick, will you just calm down? I told you I was pregnant.
Good.
Right, I told you that.
Abort it.
No.
I don't want...
No!
Barbara was afraid for herself and her unborn child. She moved out and took almost everything in the townhouse with her.
Barbara?
Barbara went into hiding. Min's was furious.
Barbara!
He had already lost half his fortune, and now Barbara was gone.
He had called begging to have me come meet him on a particular evening. And even though I knew that it was a big mistake, I felt as if I had to at least see what he had to say.
When Barbara arrived at Min's hotel room, he wasn't there. She waited in the hallway until well after midnight.
Whoa. Hey. Come on.
Barb.
I can see it didn't take you very long.
Barbara.
I thought you said you loved me.
I want to talk. Wait a minute. I wanted you to come here. Wait a minute. Barbara.
Who is that?
He grabbed me at first forcibly and wouldn't allow me to leave, begged me to just come in and talk. So he brought me in to his suite, and he was telling me how much he loved me, and all of a sudden the door burst open. It was the police. He threw me from his arms toward them and said, "Take her."
I have a warrant.
Barbara had been set up. Minns obtained a warrant for her arrest.
Well, it's not true. God, Richard.
He said that she had stolen his belongings from the townhouse.
Dick, why are you doing this to me?
Barbara?
Barbara was thrown in jail. And at daybreak, a police detective came to see her.
Are you okay? If you'll settle up with Dick Minns, we can forget about this whole thing.
I've got a little piece of paper here.
Read this, you sign it. We'd wipe slate clean.
He wanted a finality of their relationship, and he wanted it in writing, and he wanted the peace of mind, I guess, that he considered was necessary for him to go on without any concerns about her instituting any litigation with respect to a marriage or paternity.
That I never knew Richard Minns, that I never had a relationship with him, and I'm not carrying his child? No.
Barbara refused to sign the statement, and Minns refused to drop the charges.
Okay, then.
Barbara was formally charged with felony grand theft and aggravated assault because she hit Minns with her purse in the hotel. When she was released on bond, she went into hiding. Less than 36 hours later, Barbara miscarried. When we come back, their obsessive love affair ends in tragedy. When she was just 23, Barbara Petrovsky fell in love with Richard Minns, a Texas millionaire. 3 years later, their romance fell apart.
Will you calm down, please, and be careful? Remember, I told you I was pregnant.
Minns had Barbara briefly thrown in jail.
I had been told by people who knew him well that he was so embarrassed and angry that I had left him that he had to teach me a lesson.
Hey, look.
Minns had a private eye named Dudley Bell follow her.
I told her to be careful, to not be alone, to watch what she did and where she went. Unfortunately, no safeguard is enough. If someone's after you, they can find a way to get you.
Eventually, someone did get Barbara Petrovsky.
As I was getting back into my car, a man approached me, and I knew immediately what was going to happen.
Barbara was shot 4 times and left for dead. The bullets collapsed her lungs and severed her spinal cord, leaving her paralyzed from the chest down. At first, it appeared to be a random street crime, but nothing could have been further from the truth. On the night of the attack, when paramedics asked Barbara who was responsible, she gave them the name of her former lover, Richard Minns. Within minutes of the shooting, two small-time crooks from California, Nathaniel Ivory and Patrick Steen, were arrested for attempted murder.
You're going to do a lot of time.
When questioned, they said nothing about Richard Minns being involved. The next night, detectives met with one of Minns' former bodyguards. He claimed that 1 month earlier, a contract had been put out on Barbara's life.
So what were you offered?
$10,000.
By who?
Police learned that a man named Robert Jess Anderson owned the getaway car used by Steen and Ivory.
Hired us, Bob Anderson.
Steen and Ivory were questioned again. They identified Anderson as the man who had hired them to kill Barbara.
Then he gave us a gun and said it would be better if she was dead.
I just happened to
I noticed a little note here.
The following day, Dudley Bell's ex-wife gave police a note. It seemed to connect Mins and Dudley Bell with Robert Jess Anderson. The note was in Dudley Bell's handwriting and was printed on Richard Mins' hotel stationery. A list of guns was on the back. The guns belonged to Robert Jess Anderson. Police arrested Anderson on charges of conspiracy to commit murder.
I don't know from no relationship, I mean.
We solicited at that time his cooperation because the information that we had in this particular case certainly indicated that there were people far above Robert Jess Anderson that were involved.
Dudley's private eye, you know, and he was working for this guy.
Anderson confirmed that Dudley Bell had hired him. Then Anderson found the two hitmen. Anderson suspected that Bell was working for Mins, but had no proof. Despite Anderson's cooperation, the DA still claimed there was not enough evidence to indict either Richard Mins or Dudley Bell. Mins was never even questioned in the case. Nathaniel Ivory and Patrick Steen were convicted of attempted murder. Each was sentenced to 35 years in prison.
Order.
Just over a year later, Barbara filed a civil suit for wrongful injury against Mins and his alleged accomplices, Steen, Ivory, Anderson, and Bell. But before depositions could be taken, Richard Mins left the country.
Richard Mins remains a suspect in this case, unfortunately, an unindicted suspect in this case, because we don't have sufficient evidence in order to indict nor try Richard Mins for the offense. I don't know why Dick Mins hasn't been charged. He should have been. And no fair jury that hears that case would find anything other than Dick Mins was responsible.
Several years later, in an unrelated investigation, the FBI tape recorded Anderson bragging about the Petrosky hit. He was convicted of soliciting a murder and sentenced to 38 years.
You asked me to do a job, I did a job.
Dudley Bell was also arrested when a former employee testified in court that Bell had tried to hire him to kill Barbara. Like Anderson, Dudley Bell was sentenced to 38 years.
The court is noting at this time, and I want the record to show,
on 17 different occasions, Mins failed to appear in court to respond to Barbara's civil suit. Ultimately, a jury ordered him to pay Barbara more than $50 million.
In the amount of $58 million plus cost.
But Mins was still out of the country.
I think it's a consensus in the DA's office and the homicide division that there is at least one person that has not been indicted and has not been convicted. And until that happens, this case will not close.
Update. Richard Mins, who is not an American citizen, was arrested at a Dallas airport on charges of passport fraud. After serving a 4-month prison term, Mins was deported. Barbara's civil suit against Mins was eventually dismissed, so he paid no damages. Barbara Petrosky has since changed her name to Janie Smith. She attended medical school and is married. She now works with disabled children. Next, a young man convicted of murder claims that his confession was coerced. It was a Sunday night. Fire and rescue squads raced to a raging house fire in Aurora, Missouri. When the fire was out, they found the body of 79-year-old Pauline Martz. She had been bound, gagged, and left to die. Investigators concluded that the fire had been deliberately set.
I'd say I wasn't.
What if we had a witness that says you was?
Police questioned a local 20-year-old named Johnny Lee Wilson. Wilson is mentally challenged with an IQ in the mid-60s.
You was there before that fire started.
After a grueling four-hour interrogation, Wilson confessed, a confession he would later recant.
At the end of the interrogation, he forced my head back, and that's when I said, okay, I did it. But when I really didn't, that's when I lied.
Johnny's attorneys recommended that he plead guilty to avoid the death penalty. In doing so, he waived his right to a trial by jury. Johnny Lee Wilson was sentenced to life in prison. Over the years, the case against Johnny Lee Wilson began to fall apart. A key witness against him recanted his testimony. A convict in another prison actually confessed to the crime. But Johnny was never granted a trial.
Johnny Lee Wilson is innocent, and if he had a trial, he would probably be acquitted. I don't think the jury would deliberate more than an hour before they acquitted him. And it's a shame that he never got a chance to prove his innocence.
Update. Johnny's attorneys appealed to the Missouri governor at the time, Mel Carnahan. They requested a pardon on the grounds that there was no evidence against their client.
My counsel re-interviewed the witnesses, talked to the prosecutors and the police, looked at the evidence, read the transcripts, a year-long study, and we became convinced that it wasn't appropriate, not only wasn't appropriate for him to remain in prison, but that he was innocent.
The pardon was granted. After 9 years, 5 months, and 10 days, Johnny Lee Wilson was finally a free man.
I never thought that I would see the day that I would walk out those doors and be driving away from that place. It felt great.
Following his release, Johnny was reunited with his mother and grandmother.
We hugged each other, all of us, and he was really happy.
Could hardly believe it, you know, after all those years.
He now lives in his hometown of Aurora, Missouri, where he hopes to put his long ordeal behind him.
I have no bitterness or nothing. I got so much faith, I knew sometime, somehow, that I was gonna get out. I'm just glad I did.
You're about to hear an actual 911 call recorded by an emergency operator in Wheeling, Illinois. The caller spoke from a payphone. He refused to give his name, but police believe that he alone holds the key to solving a murder.
Just someone to 1765 Stone Edge Court in Wheeling. Immediately, there's a young woman there who is not breathing. She's turning blue.
1765 Stonehenge?
Stonehenge. Hedge like a bush.
Okay, in Wheeling?
Yeah.
What phone number are you calling from?
I don't know. It's a public phone.
When were you at that house, sir?
Five.
Sir?
Yeah. Call.
The unidentified caller was right. 27-year-old Jamie Santos wasn't breathing. She had been smothered with a pillow, and nothing would ever revive her. Jamie lived just down the street from her family.
She was just like a burst of energy when she walked in. You knew she was there, her presence just would just radiate.
I think ultimately she just wanted to get married and have a family. Success was important to her. I don't think she really had a handle on what she wanted to be successful at.
Jamie used her natural good looks to earn a steady income, dancing for exclusive parties in and around Chicago.
When Jamie first told us that she was going into dancing entertainment, it was a little difficult to handle. Our main concern really wasn't the type of work she was doing, but it was for her safety. Once she reassured us that she'd have somebody accompanying her at all times, a driver, bodyguard, we felt a little bit more comfortable.
I'd just like to make a little extra money.
I don't think so. Come on, let's go. It's okay. Are you going tonight?
One evening, Jamie didn't feel well. She canceled her bookings, rented a couple of movies, and called a friend.
I don't know, maybe it's the flu or something.
The call for help came the next morning.
Send an ambulance to 1765 Stonehenge Court in Wheeling immediately. There's a young woman. She's not breathing. She's turning blue.
Paramedics found Jamie in her bedroom. There were signs of a struggle, yet Hello? Jamie's head was carefully propped on a pillow. She had not been raped. There were few clues. No eyewitnesses, no fingerprints, nothing that would yield a DNA profile. The only lead was the male voice on the 911 tape.
There's a possibility the 911 caller could be an innocent bystander that stumbled upon this. There's evidence of a struggle. Possibly somebody could have heard a struggle. Possibly somebody could have seen somebody running from the area and seen an open door.
Anybody home? Hello?
911 caller could be afraid to come forward, thinking that they'll be accused of being the killer when in fact, you know, they were a bystander.
It is also possible that the 911 call was made by the killer himself.
Hey. Hi. Hey, can I come and talk for a while?
We don't have evidence that there was forced entry, so there's a good chance the person was an invited guest.
No, don't.
It could be a crime of passion. It could have been something that started out innocently and turned bad. It could have been a domestic type argument.
Look, I'm gonna have to ask you to leave.
What?
This is now.
Don't start.
Things went too far.
No. Don't! You're hurting me! Stop it!
Of course!
When the person realized that he had hurt Jamie, he had remorse. He put a pillow under her head. He made an honest effort to get medical help for her.
The 911 caller was very sure of Jamie's address, which seems to show that he knew her.
1765 Stonehenge Court in Wheeling immediately. Stonehenge, well, I like the bush.
If the caller did know Jamie, he might have met her while she was working as an exotic dancer. Perhaps one of Jamie's clients couldn't take no for an answer.
The 911 tape is a very important clue. We feel that with the identification of the voice and this tape, we can resolve this matter.
Here again is the 911 recording. Please listen closely.
Get someone to 1765 Stonehenge Court in Wheeling. Immediately, there's a young woman there who's not breathing. She's turning blue.
1765 Stonehenge?
I feel that this person could give us some information on this, and I can't understand why he didn't come forward and help us to relieve some of the pain of Jamie's death.
What phone are you calling from?
I don't know. It's a public phone.
When were you at that house, sir?
Right.
Sir?
If you recognize the voice, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, it was the scene of one of America's most gruesome crimes. And now, Lizzie Borden's house is a quaint bed and breakfast, and possibly haunted by those who were killed there. On August 4th, 1892, wealthy businessman Andrew Borden and his wife Abby were brutally hacked to death in their home. Andrew's 32-year-old spinster daughter, Lizzie, was arrested for the double murder.
Lizzie Borden took an axe and gave her mother 40 whacks. When she saw what she had done, she gave her father 41.
Good morning.
Hi, Sue.
Welcome to Lizzie Borden.
The Borden home is the scene of one of the most gruesome unsolved mysteries in U.S. history. Now, it is the Lizzie Borden Bed and Breakfast. Guests can discuss the sadistic murders over breakfast, the same breakfast that Abby and Andrew Borden ate on their final day. Then, they can hang out in the parlor where Andrew's head received 11 unexpected blows from an axe. And after a long day of sightseeing, they can sleep in the same bedroom where Abby Borden's body was discovered, lifeless, on the floor.
Some of the guests do try to figure out, you know, who did it.
Not surprisingly, most people do not sleep easily. Also not surprisingly, many guests have reported the inn is haunted.
I think the apparitions and all the activity that has been happening in the house is a possibility that the spirits are trying to communicate through myself, my staff, or my guests of who really committed the murders so they can rest in peace, put the story to sleep for once and for all.
Lizzie Borden was never convicted of the brutal murders. Nobody knows who committed that savage crime. Nobody except the victims themselves, and they're dead and gone. Or are they? When Martha McGinn was a teenager, she lived in the Borden house, which was purchased by her grandparents in 1947.
When I was about 16 years old, I was in my bedroom reading a book. And above my room, I could distinctly hear footsteps and the sound of, like, marbles being played. And it almost sounded like little children's laughter.
Shortly afterwards, Martha witnessed something even more disturbing.
I went up the stairway, and the window at the end of the second floor corridor just began opening and slamming shut. It was just violently going up and down. I got the creepy crawlies that time.
Martha wasn't completely sure that there was a ghost in her home until she made the mistake of going into the basement alone. According to legend, Lizzie hid the axe here, the one she supposedly used to butcher her father and stepmother.
A shadow, sort of like a silhouette, floated maybe 4 inches above the floor. I could tell it was a woman. I could tell it was Victorian clothes. I just turned around and ran back up the stairs. That experience really did frighten me. That actually did make my hair stand on end.
Years later, Martha inherited the Borden house. She decided to turn it into a very unusual bed and breakfast. Using crime scene photos, Martha replicated the home's exact condition on the day of the murders.
Thank you. When we first opened, I had hired my staff. Most of them at the time did not believe in ghosts or apparitions or anything like that. And then odd things started happening to them.
I arrived at work to start cleaning the house. I was on my last room and I had made the bed, cleaned, dusted and everything. And then I turned around and there was the perfect impression of somebody laying on the bed. The indent in the pillow, in the bed. I looked at it for like a couple of seconds and then I booked it out of the room. I had to leave. I was just, it scared me because I had never seen anything like that before in my life.
Carrie was white as a ghost, forgive the pun, but she was really pale. And I couldn't get her back in, not even to get her paycheck. She would not come in the house.
It was in this room that Abby Borden received 19 hacks to her face. Some are convinced that Abby is now trying to communicate with the living. Andrew Borden was killed in this parlor, his half-sitting, half-lying body slumped across the Victorian sofa.
I was sitting in the parlor and on the phone, and this strange feeling came over me, a very eerie feeling.
Hi, Sally. It's Eleanor.
When I looked up to the kitchen door, I saw what I thought was all this smoke coming out of the kitchen.
is that?
And I thought to myself, well, that's strange. There isn't anybody in the kitchen cooking. Why would all this smoke be coming out? The way it traveled, very slow, until it got to the sofa where Mr. Borden was hacked to death.
I'm freaking out. This is too weird.
And it just dissipated. I know I saw something that was out of this world. It wasn't from this world, that's for sure.
What's going on in the house today in terms of things that people are experiencing and seeing and hearing certainly has a lot to do with the fact that a violent, emotional act went on here.
Author and ghost hunter Catherine Ramsland believes that Andrew and Abby Borden are trying to tell us who killed them. Catherine and a B&B employee hoped to document the paranormal activity. They went to the basement with a voice-activated recorder.
It was very dark, and I just simply said,
"Is anybody here?"
And we could see that the recorder was activated, though we could hear nothing. It was absolute silence, and yet it was clear something was being recorded. So I decided instead of asking any more questions, I would just see what we had gotten.
Anyone here with us?
We shot up the steps because we weren't staying down there with that, whatever it was.
Catherine feels the recording is the first solid evidence that Lizzie, Abby, and Andrew still walk these halls and haunt these rooms. And she hopes that someday, maybe, one of them will tell us what really happened on August 4th, 1892.